Welcome to the Boiled Sports Handsome Hour live cast for what is today? It is right the October 15th, no, 16th, right in the middle of, it's National Bosses Day. Anish, I don't know if you knew that.
I don't, I'm not a boss, so I don't. I
have so you don't have this. Oh, I'm getting the feedback of our help. Stand by, everyone. All right, that's all fixed. So here we are on the official day. It's only, what, how many hours? What are we about? 6 hours past the sinking of Commodore Hazell's ship.
Rest in peace. It was a good run.
And it feels it was not a good run. And
it wasn't a good run at all. No, it wasn't.
But you know, he was 9-33.
9-33, yeah.
But he's 3-3 this year.
Hey,
isn't that weird? Doesn't it feel a little weird? Like when you look at it, it makes sense. It makes perfect sense. It feels right. But then you look at the and you're like, they're 3-3 halfway through the season. That's actually not the worst thing ever.
Well, so it's just like when Danny Hope, after we knew
to a that, bowl game.
Yeah, after we knew that they were gonna fire him. They had leaked it as well as.
Remember those days when only going to a mediocre bowl was cause to get fired?
I was talking about that, to a buddy. I was talking about that, and we're like, remember the time when going to. Did he only make one bowl game?
No, or two back to back years.
I was going to say, so he made two bowl games, and two bowl games in 4 years was not enough at Purdue football. Like, to take.
But that's
Purdue
okay. I'm okay with demanding.
Oh, yeah.
Better.
Six wins is not enough for Purdue football.
Not these days. Not in the skate college landscape right now. It's not enough.
Man, and how low have our expectations gone? Well, how much would you kill for a Detroit Bowl right now?
Oh,
whatever the Detroit
just for games to matter in November. Like, man. that's you know, even some of the crappy bowl games they've been to. I remember the one that Curtis Painter won. Oh, like 10 years ago. I don't know if you were there even.
Dan LaFever.
Oh, yes.
Because we played Central Michigan twice.
We played him three times in 12 months.
Yeah, that's right.
We played him both years and in a bowl game. It was crazy. So, yeah, catching Dan LaFever. but they won that bowl game 51-48, I think. Remember that?
Yeah, they won
and
both
it was
of them.
Like,
yeah.
And it was like December 27th or something. And I remember us being like, you know what? Purdue wasn't that good this year. This isn't a great bowl game. But they're going to be the lead on SportsCenter tonight because they were in a shootout on a bowl game. And that's better than being irrelevant. So
yeah, oh, my God. And it's – I don't know. It was anyway, yes, I feel like Purdue firings only happen under the weirdest circumstances, right? Because we're a weird 3-3 right now. We were a weird 6-6 when Danny Hope was fired. But – you know, the other thing is, it's like we were all waiting for this, right? We all knew it was going to happen, right?
We all knew it was going to happen because this 3-3, it's so amazing what perspective does, right? Like if the three losses were not horrific losses, were not embarrassing losses, there's a good chance he's still a coach. 3-3, after the way he started this first 3 years, 3-3 this year is not a bad run if they don't lose 50-7. I said this to Ryan, if they lost to Maryland 50-32, I think people would be less pissed. Maybe not. I don't know, because they just lost 49-35 and he got fired.
The word was pretty much it was pretty much written after the Maryland game, wasn't it?
Yes. Yeah, and I think he just delayed it, right, with Illinois.
Yeah.
He would have been fired last week. Now what we know now is that was it. Why he wasn't fired after Maryland, I don't quite understand at this point. It doesn't matter.
I think behind the scenes, I don't know where I read this, but I think maybe it was on Knucklehead, like Brian posted it, but it was, I think he said like everybody was, what's his name? Mitch. Mitch gave him that 3-game window. He gave him whatever was right, Nevada and then Maryland and then Illinois. And he wanted to see that 3-game window before he'd, execute any action. Yeah. And he went 2 out of 3. But that's the thing with stupid arbitrary, like, hey, we got to wait for these 3 games. It's like, what did you learn anything? Like, after the Maryland game, did you learn anything? How about just evaluating every week? Because he's the kind of coach that you evaluate every single week.
How about paying $12 million for 9 wins?
$12 million from 9 wins. That's right. Each, is that each?
No. No,
Is that
his
how much?
contract was $12 million, 12.25 or something over 4 years. Over 4 years? Or 6 years.
6 years.
6 years. Because he's in year four, and they're going to pay every penny of that contract.
Every 5 point, at this point, I think they've already paid him. So it's something like just under $5 million he's going to get paid.
To go do what? He'll probably be a position coach somewhere in like a
He'll
year,
be a
right?
position. He'll be a position coach, and I think he'll eventually work his way back up to
A head coach?
coordinator. No, I don't. I
Oh.
think he's done. I think he's done being. I don't know if he'll get
I was thinking
another
about that
shot.
today too. I mean, I guess I could see him being potentially a head coach, maybe at the MAC level at most again, because you don't think somebody would take a chance
Not
because he's
even
a four
the
man,
Mac, like even below, like
like one double A or something maybe.
maybe 1AA, but even he could do a
Unreal.
he could do an FBS school, but it would be like I honestly the Mac is one of the better like
It is a
sub
better
Power Five.
feeder. Yeah.
I don't think he'll get one of the better sub Power Five jobs out there. I think it'll be something in the Midwest because that's what he is. But
He'll
it'll
be at
be
Ohio State next year when Shiano
I
gets
know.
hired as head coach at Purdue.
That's right. They'll
Daryl
just trade.
Hazell will just go over back to Ohio State, and then he'll win a national championship.
Or
Yay!
he'll take the Youngstown State job after Bo
After Bo
Pelini
Pelini
comes
comes
to
to Purdue, which that's
Is that a
probably
lead-in?
enough of a
Is that our
retrospective on Daryl
transition?
Hazell. I think so.
Yeah, I'm
I
pretty
think it's
done. We appreciate everybody listening in live, all four of you, and so we but we and if you would like to hear what we think of Daryl Hazel, I think we've done enough. Like if you piece together all of the retrospectives, like we've been pretty much doing it
Been
all in
the
the
same,
podcast this year.
yeah, and it's been the same message really since he's been here. Great guy, great representative for Purdue.
Love to
Never
talk particle
really,
physics with him.
well, right, like he's never said anything that I'm really embarrassed by at all. I
Zero,
mean,
yeah,
you
zero
know,
embarrassment.
and that's actually kind of rare. Usually these coaches are a little crazy, like the good ones.
Being a football coach is a weird job. Like you
They
have to
are
be,
very,
a
very.
little weird.
Well, somebody said something on Twitter back towards us and others, like, let's remember there's a lot of upset kids in that locker room and all. And you know, and I said, people need, yes, but well, but people have to remember that anytime someone loses their job, no matter what the situation, that sucks, right? It sucks for, and it sucks for a lot of people, family, the kids he recruited, the guys who still believe in him, donors, every, you know, the people who had to fire him, you know, it
It's
sucks.
an uncomfortable position to be in, like firing somebody, right? Or being fired, right? It's just totally like not a fun place to be, but for the good of the program, that's what needed to happen. It
And
probably needed to happen a year ago.
I think what makes me nervous about it is that no one foresaw this when he was hired. And I don't
No.
mean like there weren't even the negative type people who were like, what kind of a hire was this? I mean, at least not to my recollection. Like
No, and that's the
people.
thing. Even the people he was one of my final three. I wanted Sonny Dykes, Dave Doran, or Daryl Hazel.
Those
Those
were on our, yeah.
were the three that I wanted. I think I that was just before I joined. And I think you guys, for the most part, that's who you guys wanted.
We like Dykes a lot.
I don't think you actually now going back, I don't think you guys actually wrote about Daryl Hazel, but I
No.
do remember a lot of either it was a pie in podcast form or you guys were
Well,
after the hire or something like that.
we were doing all our write-ups in the middle of the season while Danny Hope was still a coach,
Yeah.
which didn't really go over well with Purdue football, I can tell you that. And that's part of the reason I think Hazel wasn't on that list, because that was his one really good year, and he was only halfway through it when we started writing about coaches.
That's fair.
So he became much more. I think when we really noticed him, I remember watching the MAC title game that year, and it was him against Doran, and it was a really good game. And I remember saying to Ryan, I'm like, man, if they can get one of these two guys, that'd be fantastic. And here's Dave Doran down at NC State, just missing beating Clemson yesterday. They
That
would have
was
been
awesome.
5-1 with a win over Clemson and a win over Notre Dame. And instead they're 4-2 with a bit, you know, overtime loss at Clemson. They had that kick to win it.
That
So
was awesome.
Doran's,
And
you know,
he needs a signature win, right? I think
the
that's the
Notre Dame
biggest knock
one
on him.
helps, right? The
Yeah.
Notre Dame win helps,
Well,
but Notre Dame's terrible,
I was gonna say Notre Dame might be really bad.
yeah, I guess. I mean, Yeah, I think they probably are pretty bad, but I think we know what really bad looks like, and I don't know that they're
Yeah, I
quite
think we are the aficionados of really bad,
there.
yes.
But one thing we've been doing, right? I mentioned that we did that with the Danny Hope situation. We just started writing about potential coaching solutions right away in the middle of the season, publicly before he was even fired. And we kind of made up an agreement at Boiled Sports this time that we were going to at least wait till it was clearly over. Maybe not hired, but maybe not fired, but over. The Illinois game sort of stifled that for a week for us. We decided to be respectful and not start
For
rolling
the that's a
out.
first for us.
We didn't want to have Commodore Hazell's funeral while he was still standing on the
Yes.
at the
Yes.
on the bridge.
Yes.
We thought that would be wrong. You had to wait till the mortar hits and then.
Until the final, it's just
Yes.
me.
Yeah.
So yeah.
So we scrambled into action today, and we'll be rolling out our exhaustive list. There's a few people, you're very kind, saying that they're on Twitter, saying they're very excited for our list. And I can guarantee you that the coach that you would like Purdue to hire will be on that list. And the reason I can guarantee it is because every coach ever, for the beginning of time to now, is on that list.
Yes, and if the coach is not, it was in our master. The coach was in our master list,
He
and we
was just cut
decided to cut.
somehow.
Yeah,
Right. Like,
we have
guys who aren't
considered.
alive anymore. Fictional coaches from football programs like Al Pacino from Any Given Sunday. He was in the running. We decided that wasn't appropriate.
I think to, in total over the I started this in 2014, in total there are and deleted some. And kept some and like prematurely added a couple. And there are a total of 95 coaches on this list.
I don't think we're going to actually write about
No, we're not.
95. I
We're
think
not going to write about
we got a bunch of
95.
capsules written about coaches. So what we're going to do for everyone tonight is we're going to lay out what our philosophy was or our principles around building this, what the tiers are. We've grouped things into different tiers for you, and I think most of you will agree. We've got, ranging from the stretch, the guy who. I think, as you put it, there's a universe where that guy could be at Purdue, right? There's a scenario you can concoct in your head. It's not Nick Saban, right? But there's a scenario you can concoct in your head where Kevin Sumlin could come to Purdue because he went to Purdue, he coached at Purdue, right? So you could talk yourself into that, at least in some dreamland scenario. So we want to have our stretches out there, and then we want to work our way down to basically the guys who've coached, five games in the MAC, and they're kind of your, or are just a coordinator somewhere, right? And that's kind of down to your. I don't know, how many tiers did we go down to? We have like stretch tier 1, 2, 3, 4. Is that what we're down to?
So we have five, like we have four functional ones, and then the rest. We're actually
The
going to
rest.
also, yeah, we're actually also going to be organizing this. So the way we'll do it is that over the week, we will publish our like descriptions of these people. But coming tomorrow morning, we'll just publish the full list. And so we have it organized into separate categories, like subcategories of those four tiers, five tiers, stretches. Every MAC coach. We're just, I mean, like we're Purdue, so let's look at the MAC. We'll look at every MAC coach. Brock Speck gets his own category. Then the old guys, our favorite candidates, which I think we're going to roll out on Wednesday. There is one, two, three, four, five, six, seven of those, of our favorite candidates. And then the intriguing list. So these are either assistants or head coaches. That would be really like cool risks to take, but like really intriguing risks. And then on Friday we'll go over either the extremely young or the extremely risky. I think Friday will be the day where we get kind of our grievance list
Fridays
out of the way.
pretty. Fridays are fun, right? Fridays are
Yeah.
when, like everybody's wearing jeans to work and you throw out your list of coaches that will piss everyone off or be
But
dangerous,
let's head into the stretches. So
Yeah.
you wrote about these. Who are the three guys that in there is a universe in which Purdue could hire them, but it's very, very unlikely that Purdue will hire them.
Well, I think obviously the one that everyone gets excited about. And almost, I think it's funny, people almost don't want to say it out loud, is Kevin Sumlin, right? They're like, do you think Kevin Sumlin could come to Purdue? Yeah, he could. He could in theory. I do think that that's actually a possibility. It's a non-zero, right? Right. Anish, one of your favorite terms. I mean, he's a
It's my
one
favorite.
percenter. I mean, so he's one of the ones where on our list, we basically say, this guy would have to get fired, right? Because it's not like we're suggesting Purdue's going to hire him away from A&M and pay his buyout, right? So let's assume that they get pissed, which is looking more and more unlikely because they look pretty decent. So Kevin Sumlin's one of them, and we write a little bit about. We're gonna show you our template for this. Is we're gonna explain to you why a coach would succeed, why he might not succeed, and whether they would come to Purdue. Just our opinion on whether they think they would actually consider it. And so he's one of those guys where you can kind of talk yourself into it because he's been there. A lot of upside, obviously. Pretty big stretch because
he's the favorite son. I mean, like, let's not.
He's the Drew Brees who's not. Yeah.
If he would come, it would be amazing. If Sumlin would come, he would be amazing, and it would be great, and it would succeed almost instantly. He'd be an instant recruiter. It would turn around the program. It would be one of the few hires that wouldn't take more than a couple of years to turn around the program. It would turn around, like, the energy and the enthusiasm and the trajectory of the program almost instantly. It's also not going to happen.
It's not going to happen, but the second one. Is another name that's being thrown around, and it's, what's interesting to me, Greg Doyle today wrote about this, and I think Norlander tweeted about it yesterday, that Les Miles' name is actually coming up from a number of journalists.
Dan Wetzel at Yahoo was the big one that put that out there.
You know,
I have a theory. The Wetzel thing, I think. This is an indication to me, not that Les Miles wants to coach. So we're talking about Les Miles. Mm-hmm. This is a theory that Les Miles does not want to go into a TV booth next year. And the Big Ten is a good, really good conference. And the only Big Ten job that's going to open is Purdue. Purdue is going to be the only open job in the Big Ten next year.
He's not necessarily getting an SEC offer.
And so this tells me that he told his agent, hey, I want to get back into coaching. And everybody knows it's an open secret that right now, as of this moment, Purdue is going to have a job opening. And it is one of the better ones outside of LSU, mostly because there aren't that many open jobs right now. So I think his agent told Dan Wetzel, hey, we're interested in Purdue. He wanted to put that out there basically to all the other athletic directors that said, hey, Les is going to really want to coach next year. I really don't think he's going to end up at Purdue.
But I think you would agree there's a sizably greater chance of him going than Sumlin.
Absolutely. Oh, yeah. I think it is much more realistic than Kevin Sumlin, and also that Les Miles ends up as Purdue's head coach, and also a very, very unlikely thing. Like,
yes.
I also don't think
that's why he's in the stretches list.
Yeah,
but
exactly. Who's the third one?
So, the third one on our stretches list, and this is a really interesting stretch, I think, is Charlie Strong, because he's at Texas. He's probably going to get fired from Texas. He's actually following, wouldn't you agree, it's almost like an eerily similar to Daryl Hazell trajectory. He hasn't lost as much, but he's on a path where it's like what he's doing is not enough, and they're not going to be patient with him. And it just has this feel like everyone was excited, everyone loved it, and here he is being kind of squeezed. And it almost feels like it's over before it actually is over.
To your point, because we all know that Herman, if he wants the job, he's going to get
Tom Herman from Houston is going to wind up at Texas most likely. That's what I think. But
To your point, though, very similarly to Hazell, Charlie Strong only had really one and a half unbelievable years
at Louisville, and a bunch of 500 years. And I don't want to be the wet blanket here, but I think a lot of people like Charlie Strong. I like him too. I think he was a good hire for Texas. But the people who act like, because there was a lot of reaction, if he got fired, that he should, Purdue should snap him up. I think that if you're going to put these guys in the same tier, Kevin Sumlin and Les Miles, for example, there's immediate recruiting credibility, right? You get kids to come there that will just come because they want to play for a guy, one of those guys. I don't know that you get that for Strong. You get some of it. You certainly get more than you do with Hazell or Brock Spack or one of these guys that, aren't a recruiting name, right? But I don't think you get as much as some of the top-tier guys on our list. So those are the stretches. And, yes, please share your comments with us, of course, at any time and through any venue, Anish's personal email or his actual mailbox or the preferred ways to get that to us.
Sure.
Just put his face on an envelope.
Anish Ramaswamy at dsnuts.com.
No, but I am curious. I'm sure people will say, "Oh, I got 10 more stretches that would be." Of course, you could go crazy with this, right? But those are the ones we felt like, as you said, there's a scenario where you could see, and Strong would be a similar thing to what you just described of Miles, right? If he loses his job and says, "I want to coach, and I want to coach in Power 5," there's only going to be so many openings. So
And similarly in those. In that category, some of the ones that we didn't write about, the stretches, like in the stretch category, would have been like Dino Babers. I think he would be the perfect candidate for Purdue, mm-hmm. but he's not going to leave Syracuse. It's just unrealistic. He's not going to leave Syracuse after 1 year. Matt Campbell, similar thing, former Toledo, now at mm-hmm. Iowa State. Mm-hmm. Matt Rule. Is another Matt Rule is like one of the hotter candidates out there, but he's not coming to Purdue. He's just going to wait out the Penn State job. He's a Penn State guy. We didn't write about Mark Hel, or we're not going to talk about Mark Helfrich at Oregon, but maybe we should. Like, mm-hmm. we'll update our list. Maybe Mark Helfrich will be available. Rich Rodriguez again, when it was looking like Arizona wasn't going to be good. Him coming back to the Midwest, but that's not happening. You know, coaches like James Franklin, Troy Calhoun, like Pat Fitzgerald, even these kind of guys. Sure, there are universes where Tommy Tuberville was another common one in my mentions. Fine, they are coaches that might be looking for a way out of their current job, but they aren't coming to Purdue, so we're not. Let's move on. Who are our let's just do the top two with the close third place right behind it. Who are those three?
Oh, our top two, our leaders in the clubhouse right now.
Yes,
that would be your favorite motivational yeller and mine.
Yes.
Bo Pelini.
Yes.
I think that started out – actually, I take some credit because I got you on the Pelini bandwagon.
And it was 100% a joke. Maybe like – it was like 90% a joke.
And then I started telling you about it, and I was kind of like talking myself into it. And I was like, he makes like $230,000 at Youngstown State. And he doesn't even have a buyout, or if he does, it's not much. He's not there for the money, and he gets paid some ridiculous amount like – I think Nebraska's on the hook for like another $8 or $10 million or something asinine like that. And they're paying him in monthly installments. It's kind of awesome. And you can't convince me that he wouldn't love to play Nebraska every year.
In the Big Ten West, it's perfect.
Can
it's
you imagine so perfect. the level? You imagine how you'd have that team ready to fire out of a cannon when they were playing at Nebraska?
Buyout risk. Candidate.
Oh, yeah.
He's low risk. He's got a decade of success under his belt.
He just wins.
All he does is win 8 games plus a bowl game. That's all he does.
Sometimes more, but minimum, yeah.
Yeah, at minimum, 8 games in a bowl game is what he wins. He brings to the table 9 wins per football season. He's a proven defensive coach as a coordinator and a head coach. He can recruit. And he's vengeful enough. He's absolutely vengeful enough to want to play Nebraska every single year.
And that's something we see as a positive.
Oh my gosh! Yes,
the rage, vengefulness. I don't care what gets you out of bed in the morning. If it makes you want to whip these guys into shape and win games, that's fantastic.
Yes.
And sports vengefulness is the best kind of vengefulness.
Absolutely. And he's a crazy person.
It's great.
He's a crazy person.
And he's crazy.
He's
the right balance of crazy.
Oh, and we are, yeah, exactly. He's not Brian Kelly. Like, Brian Kelly killed a kid. And
right.
so that's
right.
the wrong kind of crazy, and we want no part. I think we've officially decided we want no part of Brian Kelly, whether he gets fired.
Spencer Hall last night called him the little purple rage goblin. Because, I don't know if you heard what happened, he got into the face of a strength coach of Stanford. And somebody said, that's how you get your teeth knocked out. Like the strength coach. Because apparently the strength coach walked by him after the game and just said, bye-bye. That's what he said. That's what Kelly said in the post game. That's why I got mad. Okay, rage boy.
He's a crazy person.
Like, he's a little brat is what he is. Anyway, so our other leader at this point is Jeff Brohm from Western Kentucky. And
I think I am a little higher on him than you are. If that's fair,
yeah.
But I think he would be absolutely perfect at Purdue. I think he would do really well. I think he's got the right balance of experience. To be fair, it's frighteningly similar to Daryl Hazell. So we'll just get that out of the way right now. His credentials are frighteningly similar to Daryl Hazell. He's 45 years old. He's at his first head coaching stop. He had 2 good years. This year he's at 4-3. But he had 2 good years at 8-5, taking over for, I think, Dave Doran.
No, Dorn was Northern Illinois.
He went to who did he take over from? We can look this up.
Wasn't it Strong?
It actually might have. It was Petrino. So he took over for he took
Oh, right,
Petrino's.
of course.
That whole yeah.
Willie
So
Taggart was before that.
yeah,
So
exactly. Who is
okay.
another? We'll talk about him. But yeah, we I think Jeff Brohm is the ideal
Jeff
candidate.
Rome is 24-10 as a head coach, 14-5 in his conference. There's an element of risk there, as you said, because he doesn't have a really strong, like, he doesn't have like 5 years of proven program building, but he also doesn't have an implosion falling on his face. He's never been under 500 in his conference. He's never won fewer than 8 games. I
And to
know.
be fair, the 3 losses that he took this year were to Alabama. It was at oh no, at home versus Vanderbilt, and then at Louisiana Tech. So 3 programs that aren't jokes, you know.
Right.
None of those are losses to be ashamed of. You wish you would have had one of them. The Louisiana Tech loss was a 3-point loss. On the road, so and to a team that's not bad. Louisiana Tech is pretty good.
So last year they only lost 2 games. One was at number 5 LSU, and one was at Indiana, 38-35. So, that's a little odd. I mean, Indiana, though, maybe we should stop thinking those things are odd because Indiana's probably a little better than any of us really want to admit.
They're really good. They're really
And
good.
in the podcast you joined Go Iowa Awesome guys last week, you guys, it was interesting. You all quickly agreed that Kevin Wilson is a is you were all buying Kevin Wilson stock,
I've
and
been
there's no
buying
reason not
Kevin.
to.
Oh yeah, I've been buying Kevin Wilson stock for years. He's really good.
He was a good hire. He was the kind of hire that Purdue needs to make, probably.
And a long-term commitment too. And he showed enough. It was a long-term commitment, and he reciprocated and showed enough so that they could stick with him even after maybe the first season or two of losing. And they were progressing, and they were being
Right.
really creative, and they were developing these running backs that were, NFL caliber running backs.
Now, I do need to mention two others that I think fall under our leaders column.
Yeah, go on.
There's a few in there, but two that I want to mention just because they're interesting. One is Bob Stitt, who I know you've got a lot of love for Bob
Would you
Stitt.
like me? Would you like me to just take over right now? Because I can just go for about a half hour on Bob Stitt. I think
Well, I don't
so.
think we need a half hour on Bob Stitt.
So here's the recruiting. Here's the pitch. Here's the
Here's the
elevator
pitch
pitch
on Bob Stitt.
to
Yeah,
everybody.
please tell me about the guy who coached at the College of Mines in the D3 level. Tell me about that.
Oh, absolutely. He does not have extensive experience at a high level. He's got 2 years at Montana, which is an FCS school, and we all know it. But he is the most respected name among colleges. He is your college coach's favorite college coach. He invented an invent an entire style of attacking offenses. The air raid was basically his, like, the reinvented air raid, and the entire Kevin Sumlin tree, or like, tree, but he's a branch on the tree of the air raid. That was all from Bob Stitt's creativity. He goes to coaching conferences every single year and like takes notes like a 24-year-old director of football operations guy every single year. And this is a dude that's been coaching a head coach, the head coach of a program since 2000, since the year
Right.
two for 16 seasons,
Right,
17
right,
seasons
right.
now. And everybody is saying, everybody agrees that we need somebody who's creative. We need somebody who brings a new offensive style. We need somebody to make Purdue not look like a joke. And to me, Bob Stitt is, if you want a another Joe Tiller-like hire, it's Bob Stitt. Bob Stitt is your answer because he's going to not recruit. He doesn't need to recruit the best player, like
Yes.
5-star players. He just needs to recruit athletes and get them to buy in. He needs to show them that it's a really fun season. He's shown that he can, put a winning locker room together. And my biggest thing is that even if he fails, it's a risk that everybody will respect. So everybody says, "Damn, you gave Bob Stitt a try and it didn't work. We get it. We get that Purdue is swinging for the fences, and we respect it. It's just, it's a, if you're going to miss, swing for the fences and miss. Don't swing for a single like Daryl Hazell and miss.
Don't you think, though, that swinging for the fences is backing up the truck to get less miles? In most people's eyes?
I just mean a risk. Like, so yeah, if in the risky, in the anywhere, in the entire realm of risks that Purdue could take, Bob Stitt, I think, is the one that is the highest. I actually don't think it's got the lowest floor, but I think it's got an incredibly high
floor. I'm going to keep us moving along here. I think one of the guys that we need to, I think that goes in that almost exact same category of a risk that is a calculated good risk is Kleinman.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So for those of you who don't know, North Dakota State's head coach, who has knocked off an FBS school, I think it's 3 or 4 years running now. Like, I heard a stat about that. I know they've done it like a few times, but when you hear it's been like, I think it's 4 years in a row, that's freaking amazing. And I kind of want a guy... He has turned that. They compete at the FBS level,
and it's, they're not. So and the thing,
how many national titles do they have? Two.
Two, and both with Carson Wentz, the chosen one, at quarterback. And he's just, it's not that he has been a coach at the FCS level. They have been the program at the FCS level.
Yes, he's 33-4, by the way.
And so, it's unbelievable. I mean, it's.
He's at North Dakota State. He's 15-1, 13-2, 5-1, or his 3 years, and so he's in his third year. He's won a national title in his each of his first two. And everyone, just so you know, when you win a national title at North Dakota State, you get the actual NCAA North national champ. You know that thing that they get at the end of the NCAA basketball tournament? You get one of those. Only it says football, because that's the actual Division I football championship. What the FBS schools play for is not the actual NCAA championship. But I know most of you know that. So I think he's a similar one to Stitt, right? Where it's a very calculated risk. Yep. It's a, and I don't mean calculated like it's a big gamble. It's a look. We're gonna push our cards. We're gonna try something. Because we're Purdue, we have to try something that's not. Bring in the next Les Miles, bring in the next, next hot, bring in somebody who, like you said, is a proven coach. And then another guy on that, and I know I'm doing a lot of the leaders, but I think that's worth it, is I think at this point, the guy with the most crazy that you're in love with. I don't know how to word that even correctly. It's P.J. Fleck. And now there's a lot of mixed emotion on P.J. Fleck. I see commenters, I even see people commenting on this chat that PJ Fleck wouldn't be good. I get that because I think Ryan said this, he's all motivation, right? He's his whole shtick is row the boat. And at Purdue with the train, you guys were talking about that on the Go Iowa Awesome podcast too. Like, what do you do when he brings in an oar? By the way, did you see that Akron burned an oar to make fun of them before their game? What are you doing?
And then what did they do?
And then got curb stomped.
It was insane. It was unbelievable. I have gone back and forth on PJ Fleck. I am on record like 2 weeks ago saying I want no part of PJ Fleck.
I know. And then you suddenly came around. It's like, no, you know what it was? It was the video I sent you. That's when you came around.
So it was right before that when I came around and I was like, this guy is the right crazy. And then when Dowd perfectly summarized that on the last podcast,
he
quoted it. And it was, first of all, Dowd did a beautiful reenactment. Oh, it was almost exactly word for word. And
when you're swimming with Turge, you're on your way to Turdville.
And then that locked it away. That was like, yes, I need either whether this guy succeeds or not, I need him in my life. I need him to matter in my life, and I want him in my life.
They are laying waste to the schedule, and they've beaten. Let me see here. They've beaten two Big Ten schools. They beat the tar out of Northern Illinois, some of the traditionally good schools in their conference. It's not even close. I mean, they're just rolling up 40. They put up 70 on a team. Like, man, that's and PJ Fleck is what? He's very young. He's not very proven as far as long-term track record, but
he's clinically insane. We have to say that. This is a disclaimer. Clinically insane.
But I don't know. The difference here too, and those of you who'd say, well, it's a lot like Hazel's one good year. Yes, there's clearly risk with hiring a guy like PJ Fleck. But his year right now, what he's got those guys doing, Hazell's, if you go back and look, and hindsight is always different, but Hazell's one good year where a lot of things went right. Like, he had a lot of close wins, a lot of near misses.
And that we all acknowledge that at the or a lot of people who were who said, how could this hire fail? Well, he's a sweater vest guy. He plays a really vanilla brand of football. We all kind of, you know, he had this like year of flukes that led him to a January whatever bowl. Yeah, and that's kind of what happened, right? He was really stubborn until the end. But yes, PJ Fleck could absolutely explode. But I can't see how you don't have him, on any short list for Purdue. You know, he's a Midwest guy and he's succeeding like this. Like, you have to have him. Well, regardless of your feelings on him, you have to acknowledge him if you're Purdue and you're looking for, you know, you're looking for a coach. And before we end on PJ Fleck and you move on to the next guy, we've on the Go Iowa Awesome podcast, me and Jacoby and Patrick came up with the brightest timeline, which is PJ Fleck to Notre Dame and Notre Dame fans, Notre Dame fans dealing with PJ Fleck's insanity. But continue to the next.
Well, that's do we want to?
So I have, so to me, we can go to the old guys right after this one, but
sure.
Let's talk. So there's one guy on here that I actually think if there's some corner of Vegas that has odds.
Just the Purdue coaching odds. Right. I'm sure there is. And I'm heading there this Friday, so I'll be sure to check it out and let you know.
I'll text you. We'll talk off air.
That'd be great.
But I would put money on Bob Diaco being Purdue's next head coach. Bob Diaco is the current head coach at Connecticut. He doesn't have a great record at Connecticut.
Where oddly, no one wants to coach. Have you noticed
that? But that's the thing. Nobody wants to coach there. Edsel invented the program at Connecticut, who Edsel is one of our guys. We'll touch on really quickly later. But in his first year, he went, inheriting a disaster, he went 2-10. Then he went 6-7 and led them to a bowl game in 2015. And he's currently 3-4. And probably on pace, like the odds are better than not, if you look at their schedule, that they're probably going to make a bowl game. He plays a hard game against UCF that they have to win, but then they play East Carolina. Temple is the toughest one on their schedule by far. And then they have Boston College and Tulane. Tulane's coach is actually a very good one. It's a 50-50 proposition for them to make a bowl game. And to me, it is... I don't know. It makes a lot of sense for Purdue. It's a guy from the Midwest. He's got Notre Dame connections. He used to be a Notre Dame assistant. I think he used to be their offensive coordinator. Is that right? I have it down somewhere. Defensive coordinator. I'm sorry. He was a defensive coordinator for Brian Kelly at Cincinnati as well. It's at UConn, which by definition is a stepping stone job. And so I think it's Diaco is a likely one. I wouldn't be thrilled with it.
Inspiring, I think.
Yeah.
And we've also got, and we don't spend, I mean, we've got Link Go Riley on our leaders list as
yes.
well.
Might and that's, still. I feel like I, I'm yes. Okay, yeah, good. I think that's my, I think Link Riley is my doing. I putting him on here this high, I think he's college football's Brad Stevens. He's the young guy, the young up and coming assistant coach. Everybody raves about him. He has no skills with the media. Like literally all he is football. I think he's young. He's like 33. He's probably going to wait out, at Oklahoma and probably just camp on that job. But, if any school anywhere pulls Link Riley, they'll succeed. And so he's on there, but he's not leaving. So now we can go into, the old guys. Who are the old guys that, we can even just name them off. We don't have to go too much in depth.
Well, I can't, okay. So we can just name them off, but there's a guy that we have to talk about. And, I'm not sure what his nickname is. I think you have 1 or 10 for him.
the Cajun Creole man.
You had something
alligator skin beignets,
sweat stained grits, or something. Yes, Ed Orgeron. Orgeron? Orgeron. I never say it correctly. You always have to correct me.
Orgeron.
So
Orgeron.
he's one of your absolute. See, that's why we can't get him, because I'll never say his name right.
Yeah.
Man, you would love a scenario where Ed was at Purdue, because he is certifiably insane as well, and a good football coach. Man, that'd be
I
fun.
think he is incredible. I love every part of him. I'm going to tweet out right now that I am talking about Ed Orgeron. So if you give me a second,
Why are you going to tweet? Because you think that'll lead to more listeners or something?
I'm just going to
More
tweet about
viewers?
it. But I would
Oh,
love
you
him.
just, I got you.
I would
I got
love
you.
Ed Orgeron here. All he did, so he was an abject disaster at Ole Miss. If you read Bruce Feldman's book, he took off his shirt and tried to wrestle with some of his players, challenged his players to wrestling matches. He's an insane person. He's crazy. He's a crazy, insane animal person. But he went 6-1 as interim at USC. He's currently probably going to lead LSU to a winning record. He's beloved everywhere he goes by his players. His players would run through brick walls for him. He's a giant bowl of gumbo. I love Ed Orgeron so much. I love him so much. He's insane. It takes an insane. So I think another, we're quoting Spencer a lot, but another Spencer Hall quote was that it produces a job for a crazy person. And I responded, absolutely. So we have our four crazy person candidates, and we're going to go, or five. We'll go over our fifth one later. But Les Miles is a crazy person, but they're all different kinds of crazy, right? PJ Fleck, Les Miles, Ed
Bo
Orgeron,
Pelini.
Bo
Bo Pelini.
Pelini. And the next guy we're going to talk about, Greg Schiano, are all insane people. And so one of those, I think they'd be good at Purdue. But yes, I need Ed Orgeron in my life.
Yeah, I think Ed Orgeron might be the one that you'd be the most giddy about.
Yes, without a doubt. I
Just a
mean, like
bunch of
there's
these guys, you'd be
Sumlin,
excited. Yeah.
but
Well, no, Sumlin, you'd be just genuinely
yeah.
psyched. Like, this is going to be great. Orgeron, you'd be like the possibilities, because someone's not as crazy, right? Like the possibilities would be just, you wouldn't know where to begin. The
Oh,
shirts
I'd
you'd
be.
start making, the dishes you'd start cooking and putting out recipes. With that, we'd have a weekly post about Ed's from Ed's Kitchen.
These
I
are
mean
all
just,
ideas that will absolutely happen if Ed
oh,
Orgeron
it'd be
gets
fantastic.
hired
It'd be
to
fantastic. That would be
Purdue.
so fun. That would be so fun.
Greg Schiano.
So Greg Schiano doesn't excite me at all, quite frankly. I don't think he excites anyone. Now, Greg Schiano, people should not overlook what he did at Rutgers. Rutgers is showing you right now how hard it is to be a good program at Rutgers. And they were terrible. I grew up in New Jersey. I have a lot of friends who went to Rutgers. When I was at Purdue, I shouldn't say we, because Anish and I are far apart in age. He's actually my illegitimate son. And I was at Purdue. And my friends at the same time were at Rutgers in the mid-90s, and Rutgers was, they had a winless season. They had an 0-11 in there. They had like a 1-10 in there. Like, that was a just dreadful moorbound program, right? And they didn't get much better before Schiano came in, and he came in there and he got them up to top 10 ranking.
Unheard of. I mean, Rutgers.
They were playing
Rutgers.
games as like the seventh team in the nation. Now, they were in the Big East, the old Big East, that actually had some good, Louisville and, well, I guess Miami was in that Big East. So he did a great job there, and I think he won four or five bowl games.
And Pitt was in there, Cincinnati, West Virginia.
So that should not be that can't be overstated how big a deal that really was. Then he went to the NFL and his players wanted to kill him, which sometimes happens when you're a college level coach and you try your college player tactics on the NFL, right? That hasn't worked for him, Spurrier, a lot of guys it hasn't worked for.
I mean, to
So
me, honestly, like it to a lower level, I guess. But you say that he went to the NFL and his players wanted to kill him. You look at Rick Pitino. Like to me, one of the closer comparables for his thing was Rick Pitino. Rick Pitino
Right.
took over the Celtics, and they were just so bad. And Rick Pitino thought it was about him, because in college it was about Rick Pitino, not about the players. In the NBA, it's about the players. That's why somebody like Brad Stevens succeeds in the NFL, like transitioning from college. That's why Chip Kelly failed at his first step because he thought it was about him. He thought he was the system instead of fitting his players to it. And so to me, it's like, why wouldn't you want to give that guy a second chance? Because you want to be the guy that gives, you know, an old successful head coach a second chance after his first failure. You know what I mean? So Schiano kind of
his failure was at the NFL level too. I mean, he was not a failure in college by any stretch.
We're talking about Greg Schiano. It doesn't seem like Greg Schiano is he's on the crazy spectrum, right? He is probably towards the Brian Kelly end of the crazy spectrum, but he didn't kill a kid. He didn't kill a kid, right? He's probably closer to Bo Pelini, right? He's just an ornery jackass, right?
Somebody in our comments of this live chat, who was it? Jeff Chamberlain said Pagano should be looking for a job soon. Ah,
that's another
Chuck
one.
Pagano's on the list. Chuck Pagano. You guys, Chuck Pagano's on the list. He's on all the lists. Everyone's on the list. I told you this. Everyone's on the list.
Chuck Pagano, as a Colts fan right here, I actually don't know what's going on in the Colts game, so I'll probably check this while I'm talking. Oh, yes. But Chuck Pagano, for a Colts fan, would be killing two birds with one stone.
I think the Cubs have a game. You would be okay with Pagano. You'd almost be, right? There'd probably be some Purdue fans who'd be happy he was gone from the Colts and happy he came to Purdue.
That would be me. Count me as one of those people. Because I think he would be a great college coach. I think
his players would love him.
I think he'd be amazing at the U. I think he'd be incredible. He'd be, how many times have I brought this higher up? You know, what am I going to bring up right now? Illinois. A day into the new athletic director's tenure, brought in Lovie Smith, fired Bill Kuechly,
fired the guy they'd just given a contract to, hadn't coached a game under that contract,
and brought in Lovie Smith, who just got fired from Tampa Bay. I think that the Purdue's answer to that would be Purdue's got a Colts connection. So seeing if Chuck Pagano and even Ryan Grigson are on their way out, because if one's on the way out, it probably means the other one is too. And just waiting it out and giving him the reins. And I think, could you imagine him on the recruiting trail? I think Chuck would be incredible on the recruiting trail.
By the way,
and again, he's not a great coach, but whatever, recruit your players, be a magnet.
We've talked about this before. Recruit your players and then bring in the right coordinators. You don't have to be a great coach in football if you have the right guys there with you. Or you can be a great coach and not have great coordinators, but you can't be marginal coach with mediocre coordinators.
The year that the Colts had the most success, unfortunately, was the year Chuck was out for camp. But this goes to your point. He hired the right guy. He hired Bruce Arians. And when nobody else wanted to give Bruce Arians a chance, one of the Pittsburgh Steelers, one of the best organizations in football, they are one of my most hated teams, and I live in the dang city. But they didn't want any part of Arians anymore, and Chuck knew that Arians was a genius, and so bringing in somebody as a coordinator is a really big strength. I think Pagano would be a great one.
Pagano to Purdue with Arians as his OC.
Why not? Why wouldn't he take that?
Now, Rex Ryan will be available soon.
Rex Ryan will absolutely. Rex Ryan will be very available soon.
Rex Ryan actually should be a college coach. Talk about a guy that players would run through the wall for.
I think so. Rex Ryan is on our controversial list. Controversial old guys list, but
one thing I want to say before we leave the Colts thread is that Ryan Grigson should be fired simply for having recommended Daryl Hazell. That's not fair.
He's so bad. Doc Holliday is on our list. I think the highest one was Michael. I think Michael wanted Doc Holliday very much. He brings a system, and he's an old guy, and Purdue would probably be his last stop. But I don't think anybody's getting him out of Marshall.
No, I don't think he wants to go, and I don't think that'd be that inspiring. Although you could draw some parallels to Tiller coming over as a kind of crusty guy who's just going to run his thing, and like you said about, gosh, who were you saying
Stitt?
It about? Stitt. It doesn't matter who he brings in. It doesn't matter who he recruits. It sort of matters, but it's not critical that he goes out and gets four stars because he's going to run his system and win or lose,
And
right?
everybody
So.
knows Marshall's head coach, you know. Everybody, when you say, "Hey, Purdue hired Marshall's head coach," it's not like you have to explain to most recruits who Marshall is. The other thing, you might have to explain who Stitt is. Stitt's not gonna, exactly. Stitt, nobody's going to know who Bob Stitt is. Chris Kleeman, at this point, I don't think you're going to have to explain too hard. Like, people say, "Oh, who's Chris Kleeman?" Oh, he's the guy that coached Carson Wentz to two championships. That seems to be a good qualification. I don't know. In a similar vein, Bud Foster. Or actually, yeah, so let's do Bud Foster first. But Bud Foster has apparently some skeletons in his closet, which is why he hasn't gotten too many head coaching offers. But Virginia Tech's defensive coordinator, and Virginia Tech's defense has been pretty great for the last decade. I'll take him.
And Bud Foster, I think there was a lot of people who were surprised that he was – because he kind of – there were a lot that felt he maybe should have been the successor there. So, you know, and he's just the associate head coach. So I don't know. I feel like if you're looking for a reason why you could get him, maybe that's it. But to me, he feels like a lifer.
I don't know. I think it was a weird transition, and he's got a lot of loyalty to Virginia Tech. I assume it's because they didn't fire him after whatever happened. And so, to me, I think he's waiting for a head coaching job. And I don't know if he's a Purdue kind of hire. He's definitely not an old Morgan Burke hire. Like, Morgan Burke wouldn't come anywhere close to Bud Foster, even if Bud Foster might have been successful. But who knows? Who knows what Bobinski did? Bobinski fired Hazell in the middle of the season, and we all know Morgan Burke would never have done that. So nobody can really guess. Nobody can even guess what's going on, like what the mindset of the new administration would be. We put this guy on here. He's not going to come. Ken Niumatalolo, Navy's head coach.
Navy's head coach who still runs away.
Another triple option coach. Similar to Paul Johnson.
Bring the triple option to Purdue.
Exactly, similar to Paul Johnson. I don't know if Mike Bobinski would ever touch a Paul Johnson.
Single wing at Purdue and West Lafayette.
Yeah, but it'd be fun. Niumatalolo would be fun. Bruce Barnum is another one similar. He coaches out in Portland State. It's another like highly ranked FCS school who like kind of reinvents, you know, that offense. It'd be another one like that.
But, no passing at all. I always like it when you see Navy, you know, it's amazing that they win as many games as they do, because it's like, you know, all rushing attempts, and like their quarterback will be 2 of 3.
But it's a weird, it's how do you like prepare for that?
Well, that's what's amazing is you can't, it's like nothing you've prepared for all year. That's why it works, because teams get 1 week to prepare for it.
It's
like, and that's it. And then they got to go back to preparing for normal offense.
So, we touched on
that's what would, like you've said before, that's what would work at Purdue. Do something different.
Exactly. Anything different, right? Anything creative, anything risky, I am for. Because a Hazell-like hire, we've already seen, you know, a Diaco, you know, or somebody like that, I don't think it's going to work. But think outside the box is what we're trying to say. Speaking of well inside the box, I think you out on the East Coast, you elite East Coast elitist, can talk about Randy Edsall a little bit. And I think we touched on Randy Edsall a little during the Bob Diaco thing, but I think Edsall would be pretty great. Or I mean, Edsall would be one of those like similar hires. I think you just went out on me, so we will wait. But obviously, technical difficulties on this Bold Sports podcast. What else? What else are we if we aren't just a series of technical difficulties here at Bold Sports? Hey, there we go. There he's back.
Just frozen solid for, you know, a minute or so.
That's fine. Talk about Randy Edsall.
So Randy Edsall, you know, it's funny because I brought him up, I think, to you, and you said, I don't mind Randy Edsall so much either. And like, Randy Edsall did a great job at Connecticut. I'll just always love him because he beat Notre Dame at Notre Dame, and I think Connecticut's first or second year as an FBS school. And then he kind of had a tough go of it at Maryland, and he had a very, like, he was starting to crack last year, like getting really pissed at the questions and stuff, and he got run out of town. So he's on the old guys list. I don't even know if he's that much of an old guy, but he's on the list as a a guy that I think we could see coming to Purdue, right? I mean, I think that's the thing. We could see him there. He would be a Purdue-ish hire in some ways, I think.
Mm-hmm.
I think he wouldn't be super inspiring, but I don't think – let me put it this way. This is a lukewarm endorsement. I think there are worse things Purdue could do than hire Randy Hazell. That's the best I can say about that. I think that wouldn't be super inspiring, but he wouldn't – I wouldn't be immediately terrified.
Oh, 100%. See, right. But what if – so in a similar vein, a coach that had some level of success and then tailed off, what would happen if they hired Gene Chizik, who's now, the coordinator at North Carolina?
Yeah, I am not a Chizik fan because I remember how awful he was at Iowa State, okay? And now people will say, well, it was Iowa State. Right, but this is Purdue, okay? So Gene Chizik won when Auburn was cheating and paid for Cam Newton. I mean, you know, when Cam Newton decided against all odds to go to Auburn, where he had never shown any interest. He'd never shown any interest in Auburn at all, but they must have made a great recruiting pitch because then he went there and won a national title. And this is coming from someone who really likes Cam Newton. I actually like Cam Newton. I think I've told you this. I like him way more now than I did when he was in college.
Sure.
I look at him as a bought and played for player in college. And as a pro, I think he's phenomenal. And I like the fact that he makes white people angry. It's one of my favorite subplots. It's like, you know, how dare he flex? How dare he dance? How dare he do things that instead of just go back and thank everyone? I'm diverging there. But I think, you know, if they get Gene Chizik, they will also need to get Cam Newton. And I don't know if that's possible.
Does LeBron James have any eligibility? He's got eligibility,
right? Oh, my
gosh.
He would be – what a badass tight end he would be. He would just be impossible to tackle, wouldn't he?
Oh, he'd be incredible. I think LeBron James would be great at anything, but you know me.
I know you got became a really big Caps fan in June.
That's right. Let's forget.
Wait till we start our off-topic podcast and talk about the NBA.
I can't believe we went an hour without talking about this guy. The guy that we probably should have talked about at the beginning, and we will we apologize for right now, but Brock's back.
Yeah.
Let's do the Brock Speck thing.
You know why? Because Brock is easy to forget. Brock is easy to overlook. Other coaches will overlook him. Recruits will forget who he is.
Man.
I am not a Brock Speck fan. Now, I appreciate what he did at Purdue. He was actually a pretty good defensive coach, coordinator, a decade ago. And he's been at Illinois State, and he hasn't been even – has he even been sniffed at?
No, because he's bad.
Power Five. Think about this. We're talking about a Power Five job. And the people who are trying to talk themselves into him, okay, I know he knows Purdue. I know he knows – a little bit about what wins at Purdue because he was there when it was happening. But he wasn't the only – he had Joe Tiller. He had – you know, they could point to Drew Brees and things like that. I know there were some defensive players he coached that wound up in the NFL, but the same could be said for Danny Hope.
Okay, I think it's a very similar to Danny Hope hire, and if there's anything that makes me run away as quickly as possible, it's the words very similar to Danny Hope.
I think that we would be able to do another Twitter feed mocking Brock Speck, though, would be my guess. I think that'd be possible.
Daddy Dowd would grow a mustache so fast.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, I think we all would have to do that. An all mustache podcast.
I'd say, I do. I look good with a mustache right now. I look good with a mustache. I'd be fine. quickly over the MAC. The coaches that matter in the MAC, you seem to be highest on Jason Candle.
I like Jason Candle. I don't know why entirely. I don't know. I just like what I read about him. And
I'm similar with Chris Creighton. Like Chris Creighton and John Bonamago. Chris Creighton is at Eastern Michigan. A little more length of success than Jason Candle. And John Bonamago is a little similar at Central Michigan. Actually, he's got like a long track record. I'm similar to you. I have no reason for liking these guys more than others. But if we were going to hire out of the MAC and it wasn't going to be PJ Fleck, I wouldn't mind those guys. I think Michael is highest on Rod Carey, the IU guy,
right,
at Northern Illinois. How do you feel about Rod Carey? Do you have feelings?
I like Rod Carey. I like him. I don't know what more to say than that. I like him. I think he's a little more, and I could be wrong. I know I've read about so many different coaches in the last 2 weeks, 3 weeks, that I could be melding things together. But I feel like Rod Carey has a little bit more of a, I don't know if proven's the right word, but then the guys like Candle that we're talking about who really
oh, sure.
don't
so
have any track
he's,
record, right? Like, Carey makes you more comfortable, right? I feel like, but I come back to the same concern with guys like that is, are they going to be able to recruit against Jim Harbaugh?
Yeah. I mean, you know, could, like, are they going to even be going to be able to recruit against Kevin Wilson? You know, that's
right.
what
that's
we
like,
have
let's
to...
start there. Good point. Let's start there. And what's his name at Pat Fitzgerald and,
yeah.
and even Lovie Smith.
Yeah.
I mean, that's where you're at with programs. And that's the kind of coach you have to recruit against. So that, that
he
well.
Took, he took over for Doran. He went, 12-2 and
right.
11-3 with
right.
Doran's teams, and then went 8-6 in 2015 with his own, and he's currently 1-6.
Yeah,
so that's not great when you start to have your own team. And
guys are hashtagging in the comments on this chat. Never SPAC. Although one guy wrote the SPAC is back, so
who knows. Who knows? We're very mixed on Brock Speck. From Jeff, is Hope's resume website still alive? He must be furiously forwarding it to Bobinski every 30 minutes.
Gosh,
he burned the place down, but it would be
he
pretty
burned
funny.
The place down, and not only that, he went to South Florida last year,
yeah.
was a position coach for a year, and then left. He left to be with his family or whatever the BS. Now,
yeah.
I actually sincerely mean this. I hope that it was not a problem with one of his sons or his family or something that made him quit, because that's a guy who loves football and
yeah.
loves coaching. So it's almost like maybe he didn't like the environment. Maybe it didn't. Maybe something went wrong. But I mean, he's fizzling out of coaching at this point. I mean, he is a good position coach.
Yeah, oh
he's,
for sure.
He's the perfect amount of crazy for a position coach, right?
Like, be a good strength coach.
A great strength coach. Gosh. Oh, man. Man, hopeful Danny was always doing liftoff competitions against him. That was always one of his things.
In the Mac,
nobody can beat the old hopester.
We're talking about the Mac, and we're talking about LeBron James. His coach at Akron, you know, the coach at the school that he loves, Terry Bowden.
Coach at Akron? His coach at Akron? What are
That's
you talking
what I'm
about?
Saying. Hey, first of all, when LeBron James donates $43 million to a university, it becomes LeBron James University.
Did he donate that much?
Yeah, because he's funding scholarships he's funding $43 million worth of scholarships for people in his foundation. Because LeBron James is the greatest athlete we have. So Terry Bowden is the coach at Akron. For old heads like you, you probably remember him at Auburn doing pretty well. He went to Northern Alabama. He did pretty well. He's gone to Akron. They're okay. Not great.
He was on TV for a while in the middle.
He was on TV.
He's got that Bowden hillbilly talk, which Ryan would love to do imitations of every week. It's kind of what it sounds like.
he would be similar to some of the old guys that we talked about. He'd be a similar hire to Edsel, where the Purdue could do a lot worse. He'd be like Doc Holliday without that system. He'd just be this would be his last job. And there are some pros to that, but there are also like you never know you know when an old coach has lost it, right? And so who knows? I don't know. I think if we're hiring out of the MAC, those are the guys to keep a handle on. But besides that, I think we move on to maybe some of our to some of our younger and more intriguing coaches. And so right now, I think topping that list, who are two completely unreasonable candidates, we will say right now. And when we started this list, they weren't as unreasonable, but right now they are incredibly unreasonable. It's Scott Frost, who's the head coach at UCF and the longtime Oregon offensive coordinator, and also Brian Harsin, the Boise State head coach. Both of them, Jay Money is very high on. He's also very frozen, which is why I'm filibustering here and talking about those two. But I think Frost is going to become Oregon's head coach at some point. I think once Helfrich might be the better coach to talk about here, but Frost is going to end up at Oregon somehow. Harsin's a little more interesting. I don't. He's not, you know, the Boise State lifer. He's super young, but that might be why he won't leave. You know, Harsin is another one that's super unreasonable. We have him on here for some reason. It'd be a dream, to get somebody like Brian Harsin. But I don't think that's very likely. And now I've filibustered enough. We'll try to get Jay Money back on here very shortly. It looks like he's going to restart, so we'll get him back very shortly and start to talk about that. Do six of you in the comment section. We actually do have a message retracted in our comment section, which is pretty funny. Which is the kind of comment that I like. My favorite kind of comments are redacted comments. Rod Carey has been has been largely negative for Rod Carey. A couple of Danny Hope comments. So who knows? I don't. So a couple of you have chimed in with this. I don't think Bob Stitt comes in as a coordinator. Like, I don't think Bob Stitt leaves Montana. He's well known enough that he would only leave for a, you know, head coaching position somewhere. He's also been a head coach for 16 years. You don't go from that to being a position coach. You know, or a coordinator or anything like that, even a high profile coordinator. I remember Penn State last year was, there were whispers that they were trying to get Bob Stitt to be, the new offensive coordinator this year. But I don't know, who knows? But I don't think that Bob Stitt would be, the kind of coach to, you know, to take a coordinator job. Let me get, hey, Jay Money's back. Let's get him on. Let's see if he's here. There are seven J Monies that are just joining the call. Hey, buddy, how you doing?
Hey, did I miss anything? How are we doing? Catch me up.
I filibustered and talked about Scott Frost and Brian Harsin.
Oh, I like Scott Frost, but Scott Frost is entrenched, right? I
mean, absolutely. Both of them are absolutely
Brian Harsin. Oh, Boise State coach wins all the time.
He's gosh. Never leaving Boise State.
No, don't say
old.
That.
Not leaving Boise
39,
State.
39, even better. I like young men. Wait, we're not live, are we? Oh, I like Brian Harsin. No, don't say that. He's not never leaving. Peterson left, and he looked like he was never leaving.
I don't know. I think, but he left for Washington, and now Washington is really good. I don't think he leaves. I don't think you leave Boise State for Purdue at this point, especially if you're a young guy. I mean, like,
Washington was bad.
So here's my thing is that Utah might open up because the Utah head coach is really good, Kyle Whittingham or whatever, yes. And so he might end up at like USC or something like that.
Right.
And so you would move to Utah at this point from Boise State if you're not entrenched, like Peterson at Boise State.
Maybe,
You know, that's the kind of job.
Don't
I
kill
see
my dream.
I'm sorry, you love him. Right. My dream is Doug Meacham. Like, if we're going in these intriguing hires, I think Doug Meacham, offensive coordinator at TCU. Yes, mm-hmm. please. Mm-hmm. I mean, like, yeah, absolutely. Yes, please. That's the kind of risk that would be extremely intriguing. Right. Again, I would prefer. I think the most people in the comments too are saying that they would prefer Bob Stitt. But yeah, I think Doug Meacham is in that similar vein. He's like, I mean, like an older version of Link Riley. It's just like mm-hmm. offensive coordinators at these unbelievable. At these unbelievable spots. Right. Lou Holtz's kid is on our list. Scott Holtz. Or Skip Holtz,
Skip
I'm
Holtz.
Sorry.
Yeah, I don't. He doesn't inspire me very much.
I think so. He was Boiler Dowd's, one of Boiler Dowd's additions.
Was
Louisiana
he?
Tech head coach. Yeah, and when he brought, I didn't have him initially on the list, and I pulled up his resume, and he's, you know, I mean, he's Lou Holtz's kid, so who knows how many jobs that's got him into, but he's got that Notre Dame connection that people seem to be linking with Bobinski. He was a former head coach at what or not head coach, offensive coordinator at USF, at Eastern Carolina, at UConn. Like, he's got this long track record of coaching, and has some of those are head coaching spots, some of those are coordinator spots. Actually, I think all of those might be either associate head coach or head coaching spots.
And I know we, and I know, we know he's related to Lou Holtz, so we know he's got some crazy.
He's got to have a decent amount of crazy. He's got Louisiana Tech going. Who knows? Willie Taggart is one that you guys had on your list, in 2012. I really like him. Well, and I'll put Scotty Montgomery in a similar, band. I'll talk about them together because they both have Midwest connections, but they're not currently coaching a Midwest school. Scotty Montgomery is at Eastern Carolina. Willie Taggart is at USF. South Florida. Scotty Montgomery is from that Cutcliffe line that we all love. I think they would both be incredible. I think Willie Taggart and Scotty Montgomery both be really
Yes,
good head coaches at
agreed.
Purdue. And they'd win with passing. You know what I mean? Like, they'd be really pass heavy, and recruiting passing kids and
I have to interrupt you because Nathan Anderson asked if you would pitch in for a lifetime supply of Fancy Feast for Carl the Cat if Pelini's hired.
Yes, absolutely. Yes, we could have a cooking with Carl the Cat and only focus on cat food if you would like. I can have a cooking segment regardless of what goes on, what kind of hire comes on next year is what I'm trying to say.
Excellent. Excellent.
Another one, I mean, one that you can talk about a little more is Mike Sanford, who is the running backs coach and now the offensive coordinator at Notre Dame, and the kid of now Indiana State's head coach. Is that right?
Oh gosh, is that the connection?
Mike Sanford, he used to be
Sanford
Stanford's lead
Senior.
recorder
Yes.
recruiter.
Yeah, no, I think, I mean, right now, it's funny because right now Notre Dame doesn't look like the place you go to get offensive coaches. I guess their offense hasn't been the biggest problem. Again, he's one of those guys, I almost put it like the Edsel category, where I wouldn't be terrified. I think it'd be a slightly above average move for Purdue, but not something that would get people excited. And I keep coming back to that because I think some programs, like when South Carolina hired, just to pull something around, when they hired Muschamp, that was not inspiring. And I know a lot of fans criticize that, but and they probably needed to do something more inspiring. But South Carolina looked at themselves like, we were competing for the SEC not that long ago. We need a guy to, we don't need to do some sort of splashy. I don't know if splashy is the right word, but I feel like Purdue's not in a position right now where they're just trying to. Just a year or two ago, they were really competitive. No, Purdue's been
That was
languishing
that
for
we
a
looked
long
at
time.
that. That was the logic behind the Danny Ho or behind the
Hazel?
Hazel, Darryl Hazel hire, right? And
They
so we're
hadn't
not
fallen
there.
that far yet. It was like, we can get back to this. But, the truth is, hope was not really ever going to get them there. And Joe Tiller stopped being that coach before he retired. I mean, Purdue had some disappointing mid-2000s years where they should have won 10 plus games and they'd win eight. And yeah, fine, eight's great, but not against some of those really cupcake soft schedules. So,
If Joe Tiller had this year's schedule and this year's team,
oh
let's
my
say,
gosh,
how many games would he win?
this year's team,
Let's say it.
I'd go to a bowl. I think he'd go.
Yeah,
I think he'd
he'd
win six
probably
or
win
seven.
seven. Yeah, he'd probably
I really
seven is
think
pretty
that
easy.
because I think if this team played an ounce of defense right now, they might have another win.
Man, the new defensive coordinator who was coaching at high school last year, not even the head coach in high school.
He was a defensive coordinator.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, that's the thing. Because now you're wasting. David Blau's actually flinging the ball around okay right now,
Yeah, he's a
and
perfectly fine
he's
quarterback,
perfectly
right?
fine. And when called upon, he can throw you for 450 yards and five touchdowns.
Yeah.
And people will say, "Well, there are a couple were garbage time." They still count. He still was doing it. And a lot of colleges to that are garbage time. So let's not like. He's not the problem. Let's put it that way. Most years, people are clamoring to get the backup quarterback in there. I don't know. I don't know that's really the problem because Purdue's rolling up points every week. So I mean, except the Maryland game where everything, the wheels just came off entirely.
And actually, Terry Malone, we probably should have talked about this at the top of the podcast, but
Yeah.
we're not very organized
No,
people.
no. We're caught off guard by this firing.
Malone not getting the head coaching
Interim
thing.
job. Yeah, that's interesting.
I thought that was stunning. And to me, that would have been an absolutely Morgan Burke thing to do. And giving it to either Jared Parker or, I mean, like, when did I tweet? Not even a couple days, or maybe a week ago, that Jared Parker and Marcus Freeman are the only two things on the coaching staff, along with Terry Malone, who are worth anything.
Right.
And I thought that if Hazell was fired, if and when Hazell was fired, the interim tag would go to Terry Malone because he's the most qualified.
Go to Malone, but you hoped it would be Freeman.
Freeman, because I thought everybody loved Freeman. He already was, you know, what's his face is the recruiting coordinator. Jared Parker is the recruiting coordinator. But Malone is, you know, the co-offensive coordinator and then the co-defensive coordinator.
And most experienced guy
and
there.
The defensive coordinator, you know, is the guy that I thought that we'd go to. I don't know. I was kind of stunned by this Parker move because it's not really, it doesn't seem like what Purdue would do, which maybe means that Bobinski is really different from Morgan Burke, you know?
Or I'd love to know how that happened. Do you think that Bobinski decided this is the guy I want? Because you can't just do that. Do you think maybe he even asked Hazell? Maybe not. Maybe he doesn't care.
No, I don't think.
Did he observe the team himself? Because
I think
how do you do that?
Because Freeman came with Hazell from Kent State. So I think if he would have asked Hazell, it would have been Freeman. I think Parker, you know, Parker was almost recruited away to Kentucky this year, and they kept him on. So I wonder if, you know, I don't know.
Is he a candidate?
No, I mean, I didn't know that they would give Parker the keys.
I'm saying, is he a candidate for the job?
It would take an undefeated
run.
You'd
have to go win like 4 or 5 games.
Yeah, I was going to say it would take winning most of the games, but to give him the job. It would be, I mean, like, so honestly, the parallel I draw to this, and I apologize for keep going to basketball, but the parallel I draw to this was Frank Vogel being fired, or Frank Vogel being hired after Jim O'Brien was fired back in 2010, I think, for the Pacers.
Right.
Frank Vogel was a guy who was a Rick Pitino assistant. He was a younger guy. He was kind of unproven, just like Brad Stevens. He was on the coaching staff when the coach left or was fired. And nobody really expected it. And he was like this video coordinator. You know, Parker is this young recruiting director. And the team rallied around him, and it took, you know, at the end of the year, it took the players and everybody begging for them to get the jobs, for them to do it. And, you know, they got these veteran assistants to help both of them. And, you know, I'm saying, you know, I'm putting Frank Vogel and you know, Brad Stevens in this conversation, but like it's, and not like Parker is either one of those, but there is a universe where maybe it
works. Well, let's say, you know, I could give you the scenario that would make it on the table. He wins 3 more games, including slapping IU around.
Yeah. Becomes a conversation.
There'd be people saying, give the guy the job. He just took a team that looked like it wasn't going to win again and put him to a bowl game and beat – you beat Indiana, even if you don't go to a bowl game, people will say something about it. Like, there will be a faction that will say, look, just like the people who think that – just like people who think Brock Spack should get a look. You'd say, look, he's here and he knows how to do it. He's throwing that already. So I'm just saying, there's a scenario where that. And that's what worried you in general at a bigger level. Someone like Malone gets it, then there's a chance he becomes head coach. And that was something that we didn't want. So, right. So
Scott Satterfield at Appalachian State. It's an interesting one.
He is, but does Purdue need to be dipping into that level of – like. I don't know. I keep going back because I read Doyle's column today, and his posit, what he's saying is that Purdue should not be thinking about a guy like Spack or a guy like Hazell, not another Mac guy. They should be finding a proven guy because and this the reason I think it's resonating so much with me is I wrote something about this a while ago, probably just like you started your coaching list 2 years ago. I wrote a column about this I think sometime last year. About Hazell, where I said Purdue's now in a position where they cannot F up this next hire. They cannot miss.
No, absolutely.
You cannot miss where the program is irrecoverable. It may be now, but no, my point is, my parallel I drew in my column was, look at Michigan when they hired Harbaugh. Why did they put all their chips in the middle of the table for Harbaugh? Because they'd had Rich Rodriguez, didn't work. Then they had Hoke, didn't work. Had to pay both of them to go away. Their reputation had been seriously damaged. They had to hit a home run. It was not an option anymore to not. And I don't think Purdue's Michigan. Purdue's got less, fewer resources than Michigan. So they cannot. There's not enough money. Purdue can't pay Hazell to go away and another coach to go away over the next couple of years. This has got to be a good hire, which is why I think I related so much to Doyle's column about how you should go after established guys. His point is miles all the way, less miles all the way. So
I mean, I would.
But I can see people. But here's the thing. I'll throw back. You haven't heard me say anything negative about Miles. But I can see why people are nervous because they equate it to the Akers hire, Fred Akers.
Yep.
And if Miles has been coasting on his reputation, then that would be disastrous, right? Because if he doesn't have any tricks left in the bag to use at Purdue,
it would be bad.
Then it will be terrible.
It would be bad.
But
it'd be like Terry Bowden. I mean, like Terry Bowden would fall into that category too, at a lower level. But you know,
but people would be so excited if Les Miles was hired,
and recruits would be excited.
I think within a year or two, they'd have a really good year, and that's really what you need to get back on your feet. And really good year. By really good year, I mean 7 wins. Let's be clear. 7-8 wins would be phenomenal.
And next year's schedule. This is another one. Is that next year's schedule, the non-conference season, or this was the leading reason why Daryl Hazell had to be fired, because the first three games were versus Louisville, the Heisman winner. I can just say it right now. The Heisman winner and Mike Vick Jr. We're going to play him not even at home. We're going to play him in a neutral site in Indianapolis, and that's going to be filled
with Purdue territory. That's Purdue territory.
And then we go, we play at home against Frank Solich and Ohio. Old Man Solich is on the MAC list. I'm going to write about him today, and we're going to publish the MAC list tomorrow. And then we go to Missouri.
Yeah.
Are you kidding me? And then we. I think our first Big Ten game is Michigan. We're screwed. So you might as well have
probably
somebody
an 0-4 start.
The Boiling Points, Purdue Boiling Points at PU Boiling Points on Twitter. You probably follow them.
Oh, I know them.
In my mentions was didn't give it to the OCDC because this allows for continuity while Parker handles the day-to-day BS that comes with being a head coach, which is a very good point. I think that's a very good point. Another one was that he checked on the Danny Hope website, which is still live, coachdannyhope.com. It's fantastic. People are asking us to call the phone number in his on his website right now, which we probably won't. Who knows? No, I've got some whiskey downstairs. Let's see how far this goes.
I'm sure that's his cell phone number. I'm sure it's his cell phone number.
You reached Danny Hope. I'm Coach, sorry. That's my Ed Orgeron.
You reached Coach Hope, and my butt's in my pants. He used to say weird things like that at press conferences.
Oh, that would be incredible.
Gotta get a little better. Yeah, we'd like to have you on our podcast, Coach Hope, to analyze Purdue football.
Oh, we'd love it. Oh, my God, I'd love Coach. We'd have him as the weekly correspondent.
Oh, gosh, that'd be phenomenal.
Who takes crap on Morgan Burke harder, us or Danny Hope?
Well, and it turns out that Danny Hope may have been right.
All right, so really quickly, I know there's a long podcast, but of course it's going to be a long podcast. Let's knock out some of these maybe on the please no coaches.
Are we looking at the fired list, the potential fired list? Or are we looking at the young and the risky?
The young and the risky. So let's go with Pete Lembo. Bad. No.
Yeah, but there are people. Is he still at Ball State? No.
No. He is, I don't know, in a TV booth somewhere on a rocking chair.
So he's available, you're saying. There's no buyout.
Al Golden. What would you think about
him? Oh, man. You know, Oh man, I
Tell me
wouldn't.
why. Let me play devil's advocate here.
Yeah,
Tell
no,
me
I.
why Randy Edsall is okay, but Al
No,
Golden is
I
not.
didn't even get to answer. You were already jumping all over me,
Let's
throwing my
just
Randy
see. Let's
Edsall
just
at me.
see.
No, I think Al Golden is not radioactive. I think he had a tough go of it at Miami, and he never really had much of a chance there. But they hired him because there was promise there. So,
Because he
you
was a
know.
Temple. He was another, like Matt Rhule is Temple guy,
Yeah,
right?
and I mean, he's. But yeah, he's probably on the please no because gosh,
I
that
think
could
it I think he'd be exactly what we wanted him to be. I think he would be a guy that would get you back to a consistent 7 wins, and that's it. And then you fire him and you find a new coach. But
Right, exactly.
we need somebody to build the program up to another, like, where 7 wins out of, and a bowl game out of Purdue is, not the joke. We are the joke of the country when it comes to football. I think Al Golden, there would be lots of jokes had on the hiring of Al Golden, but I think he'd get exactly where you'd want it to be.
Right.
Cheney,
Which Cheney are we talking about? Or did
the
you
old
skip through?
Jim Cheney.
Jim Cheney?
Yeah.
I didn't even know he was on come on. Is he even alive? I think he was honored this past weekend as part of the. Did you know that that happened? The 20th anniversary of the 96 team. So Ryan texts us that one of his friends was at the game and that they honored the 96 team and that Cheney was there.
And
No, sorry, Coletta was there.
we
And.
were thinking back, and we were like,
Wait a
20
minute.
years.
20 years ago was the year before Taylor came. They were terrible. They were 3-8. And I said, "What were they honoring?" And he said, "20 years." And I said, and then Michael said something like, "By the way, I've been thinking about publishing that Voxer chat from that day because it was phenomenal." And Michael says, "Oh, I thought you were serious for a minute. I realize now that you're joking." And he comes over the Voxer and he goes, "No, I'm completely serious. 20 years."
They were like, maybe they were celebrating a win over Michigan.
Yeah, that's probably what it was. So. Yeah, I think back. No,
Oh,
Jim
that
Cheney,
was.
you know, he did some good things there at Purdue. But I don't.
This is the you're breaking up with your girlfriend, and it's not you, it's me.
Yeah, Jim, you know, I don't think you are really. You probably don't have a smartphone and certainly don't know what Twitter
So
is. And.
let's not touch Art Briles, because I think all of us would say please no to that. But what about his
No, there's a
kid?
lot of idiots who out there who think that
But
Art Briles would be okay. No, his
what
kid
about
probably. Well,
Kendall Briles? He was the offensive coordinator. He's in his early 30s.
he's young. I
He's
mean.
young. He's young, but he's got a system, and it's a passing system, and this is Purdue, and blah, blah, blah.
Yeah. No, he's risky. He's high risk, high reward, right?
Brady Hoke?
Did you even answer me? I said he's high risk, high reward.
Yes, I agree.
Okay.
Brady Hoke.
Brady Hoke is a gigantic doofus, and he should not be let anywhere near a Power Five head coaching job again. And I don't think he will be. I think
Speaking
he.
of doofuses that are that shouldn't be let near any Power Five job, Lane Kiffin.
No, you're wrong there. Lane Kiffin, I'm actually way more in on Lane Kiffin
We
than you
differ.
are. Yeah, Lane Kiffin has proven he's a good football mind.
He's insane.
Is he insane or is he just kind of a douche? I
May or
think
may
he's.
not have had sex with Nick Saban's daughter.
Well, we all make mistakes. Come on. Come on. Come on. When you have an ugly wife like Lane Kiffin. Oh, no, wait. No, he doesn't. That's right. No, he doesn't. That's the thing.
Yeah,
Got a
man, I
smoking
don't.
wife. No excuse there.
He's a fun one.
He's a weasel. Yeah, but I mean, but if we're talking purely coaching ability,
Yeah.
I think you could do a lot worse than him, honestly. And I think recruits would come to play for him.
I
I
think
think
he'd
he'd
be
bring
a,
guys in.
I think Teddy Huff in my
What did he say?
I'm gonna retweet this. In my mentions, Teddy Huff has a photoshopped Ken Bone in a Purdue jacket. I just retweeted it, and it's perfect. And I don't know who did the Photoshop. If Teddy, you did it, it's great. It's perfect. Oh, Ken Bone. We had all of what, a day and a half before we realized that he was a nut job.
Well.
But that is a great one. This is probably going to be the image of this podcast. Yes, Ken
Oh,
Bone.
I don't think. Yeah, I
Okay.
think that. In fact, that's perfect. We're going to
That's
talk about coaching
amazing.
candidates and reveal our top one, and there he is.
There's Ken. Oh, that's so good.
The thing about Ken Bone that I was disappointed. More people. I didn't see people making this joke, but not people got all fixated on the name that he was Bone.
That he
Oh,
was
Bone. But Ten Bone. It's my name and what I do. It's he could have a Match.com profile that's just his name. Hey, ladies, Ken Bone.
What's up?
No waiting, Ken Bone. Like, it just, the jokes write themselves. And I didn't see many people. I saw people second Bone Zone. I saw, you know, come on.
This
people.
Is why they give you the big bucks, isn't it?
This is why it's they the creative do. Skills that I have. So, what are we up to here? That's
so we can go to the fired list, but yeah, that's pretty much the risky one.
I think we've done enough damage for tonight. So yeah. we've talked about maybe 30 names or something here, and there's more.
There's more. Oh, there are so many more. We got Jim Caldwell. We got Tim DeRuiter. Please no. Bob Davey. Man, this is a list.
You know the cover of Sports Illustrated when the NCAA tournament's starting and it's that big collage and every single team is represented? That's what our coaching search picture looks like. It's every coach, past and present.
Tony Elliott, Todd Monken, we didn't talk about.
Oh, I don't know who half these guys are. It's kind of an amazing list.
We got people. We got Mark Stoops on this list. We got Doug Marrone on this list. Mike New is the Ball State head coach that you were looking at. Jim Tedford we got on this. We got people
Jeff
on
Tedford.
This list.
Jim Tedford his evil brother?
Yeah,
I liked Jeff Tedford a lot when he was coaching Cal. And every program goes through its ups and downs. He was there like 10 years or something, mm-hmm. and it just he kind of lost his he let go of the rope, and that's
so. One, I think it was Feldman, or maybe it was what's his name at Yahoo. We talked about
Dan Wolken
was talking about this, but he said Ohio State and Michigan coordinators would get looks. So for me, that meant he was talking about Chiano. That meant he was talking about the other who's the other coordinator? Luke Fickell. Luke Fickell is the I other mean, one.
Fickell had coaching year technically.
Yeah.
I mean, defense is something Purdue could use some.
We could use offense, too. We could use special teams. We could use...
points. Stop about the offense. Leave Terry Malone and his bucket hat alone. He's done a fine job for an old man.
At Michigan, Tim Drevno. He's the offensive coordinator and the O-line coach at Michigan. And so off of Michigan staff, that's the one that people thought.
They already have Terry Malone. Why don't we just put up all former
all
Michigan
of them.
Coaches?
Just all of them.
Get Lloyd Carr in there to coach. Why is
Brian
Lloyd Carr on
Ferentz?
This list?
Brian Ferentz is on the list? Yeah, that Ferentz's kid.
The problem is Ferentz has only accept $40 million contracts.
That's true.
12-year extensions. By the way, complete non sequitur, but again, the podcast you did with them, how alarmingly accurate was their prediction for how Iowa would win the game? They would get a lead, then they would kind of make it a little too close. Like the final score would be closer than it should be. Like I knew exactly what they were saying. The win was never going to be in doubt, but Ferentz always lets it be a little closer than it should be.
They'd make you uncomfortable at the end. They know that Patrick.
They've been watching a long time.
Patrick and Jacoby know their guy. Houston Nutt is on my list.
Oh, good Lord.
Nutt. Tony Levin. Mario Cristobal on my lists. At this point, I'm just showing off because we've got people.
So, that's like 100 minutes we've done on.
We've done a lot of minutes, and we'll publish all of the names tomorrow.
Yes, and this week there will be much rejoicing. There will be lots of content.
Hashtag content. We got so much hashtag content.
And so basically what I think we'd also like to say is this list is trademarked Boiled Sports. So you are not allowed, no one else is allowed to write about any of the coaches we've mentioned.
We're looking at you, Brian Newbert.
I don't know. I don't know what that leaves for you to write about. You can write about NFL head coaches, I suppose.
Seriously,
but this is our list. Go
GBI's,
away.
GBI's list had a lot of these names. They had a lot of names that weren't on here, maybe two names that weren't on here that were interesting candidates. GBI had a good.
I list. Choose to mean to read that as meaning that we kind of know what we're doing.
Exactly. Exactly. So thank you guys for listening. We appreciate it. The couple of you who are here live, we appreciate it. I just learned
Elaine Kiffin's wife left him. Somebody on here commented, so that's good to know she's available.
Oh, there you go. Anybody got her? Hey, somebody give her Danny Hope's number.
Lembo is special teams coordinator for Maryland. Well, Joey Freshwater. What is what?
I don't know who Joey Freshwater is. There's this so I Googled Joey Freshwater, and the first one is a Barstool Sports headline that says, "Hide your daughters. Joey Freshwater is single and ready." So
Oh,
it's the
that might be
Lane
Ken
Kiffin.
Bones. That's Ken
It's
Bones.
the Lane Kiffin, like the sexy Lane Kiffin with the mustache, if you remember that meme
Oh.
several years ago.
By the way, somebody, Jeff Chamberlain said, if Lane could bring in Monty as DC, who boy? And I mean,
Hey, I'll take
I'd
it.
take Monty Kiffin's defense.
I take
Hell's
Monte Kiffin's
yeah.
defense.
Anyway, there'll be a lot
Anyway,
more to come this week.
absolutely. Thank you guys
Thanks for
for
joining us, everyone. This has been, as always, a blast. Boiled Sports Handsome Hour. Adios.
it was my line BS all the time.
Well, yeah.
Most of the time.